गुरु कृपा केवलम। नमस्ते नमस्ते एवरीवन, वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू सत्संग टुडे। सतगुरु श्री मोजी बाबा की जय। Questions. Father, I had a sweet dream with you and Guruji a few nights ago. Should I attach any significance to dreams? Traditionally, in India especially, we've attached a lot of significance to darshan in dreams. And it's quite beautiful. But I would say enjoy it like beautiful blessings, beautiful prasad. But don't get into any sort of interpretation of dreams sort of thing. What did that mean or something like that. Just it is an enjoyable experience. And if something had to be conveyed in that way, what conveyed? You don't have to try to figure it out or what do I do with that or something like that. It's not uncommon especially for those who are devotional to have these kind of dreams, and most of them can be very beautiful. So enjoy. That reminds me of a funny story that we heard yesterday. A couple was here. The husband usually comes to satsang, the wife not so much, he's come only two times. So the husband said to her one day that she wants to come to satsang. And the wife said, no. Yeah, she didn't let him come for whatever. I don't know exactly what she said. So then she said that I came to her in that dream, in a dream that night, and scolded her. And that's why both of them were there yesterday. I said, it doesn't feel like I'm the scolding type. Does it? But I'm happy with that outcome, if it gets you to satsang. That's fine.
You're shining all bright.
Huh?
Totally, you're shining all bright.
Namaste Anantaji, my daughter of 5.5 years was asking me a few hours back where the Satsang Swamiji lives. She said she wants to see you. Some children in the past I felt I live inside the computer because the parents would always see me in the computer. Or the Satsang Swamiji thing. When you also come here expecting to see a Swamiji but you can't find one. Today I look a bit like a Swami. The shade is just a bit off, but in Tiru one time, during the retreat actually, we were all of you were there, some of you were there. We were walking on the road and there's a big group. We were all walking and the crowd was starting to look. And everyone was expecting to see like a proper Swamiji in the middle of the crowd. Everybody kept looking. where is the master here? He was walking and they were quite disappointed they didn't find one. He was like, what's going on here? We were walking from the hotel to the ashram. Sorry, paneer.
Tears.
Good tears, yes.
It's remembering or something, and I don't know what.
Yes.
But I just admit, just
yeah. Very good.
In your presence.
These are good tears?
Yes.
I was like, what am I doing back here? Only been gone 3 days. Nah, I remember this time. Sometimes she is away for 3 months. And I said,
five.
Oh, 5 months. So she was away 5 months. And I said, What, you've been away 3 weeks? She was not very happy with that. So now she's been away 3 weeks, so I was just teasing her. Right? You've just been gone 3 days.
Thank you.
Father, you say be open to everything, thoughts, feelings, etc. But sometimes openness to thoughts allow them to drag me along with their stories. It seems like a lot of holding back is required. Am I misunderstanding something here? See, what is drag me along? So when I'm saying remain open, let everything come and go naturally. So he said that when a thought comes, then if I'm open to the thought, it just takes me along with it. But what is this actually happening? What is the mechanics of this? A thought can come. What is the maximum a thought can stay? Like count the seconds a longest thought can stay. I'm not saying when it repeats. It is one thought. So he says 2 seconds maybe. So that which is going to go in, let's presume this answer is right, in a maximum of 2 seconds, it really can't drag you along. So then drag you along can only mean that it can attract my belief, it can attract my assent or something like that. If I'm open to it, it can drag me along. If I'm closed to it, then it doesn't have a chance to pull me in. So this is a very interesting discussion, because if you look at most spiritual practices ever in this world, most of them have been so that you get your attention is not so attached to these thoughts when they come and go. Whether it is chanting, whether it is be with your breath, whether it is yoga, whatever the method you might use, it is more to do with trying to control your attention so that your attention does not go to these thoughts, and therefore then the question of belief does not arise at all. Even the practice of staying with your sense of being, staying with the sense I am, then brings an anchor to your attention. And then if your attention is anchored on something, then it doesn't feel like these thought systems arise, and even if they do arise, they don't seem so strong. Now the thing with this method here is that I've hardly seen anyone gain mastery over their attention. Many try for 50 years, try to control their attention, control it, hold it so that it doesn't go to the thoughts. But it hardly ever works, and seems like a lot of sadhana is needed to gain this kind of mastery. You see? So besides this type of effort, there is also a more natural, a simpler way, and we can call it in a way the path of surrender. Which means that actually these thoughts don't mean anything till belief goes to them. So this classic example of when I say try not to think of an orange, or don't bring your attention to an orange. Very quickly the orange wants to come into attention. You see? Then you say, no, no, chant Ram. Then you can, with some practice, you can say, okay, stay away from orange, stay with Ram. Beautiful. You see? But mastery over that seems like it takes a lot of effort and time, and the orange seems to sneak itself in, you see, in the middle of Ram, like Ram, orange, Ram, no, not orange, Ram. So it can feel like a bit of struggle is there. But if I say to you, don't worry about whatever appears, whether it is orange, apple, whatever it is, don't consider yourself to be an orange or an apple. Don't consider yourself to be that which your thought is saying that you are. You see, because that's all that is happening. The thought is conveying an idea about you. You see, and you buy into that idea of what you are. So why do I call this the path of surrender? Because all these thought forms are then surrendered, they let go of. So in a way, to me it seems like a more natural, a sahaja way. In a way, all I'm saying is what the Zen master said. They said, let all thoughts as visitors come and go, you just don't serve them tea. So, including the thought that you could be dragged along, or it's you could be taken away from your center or something like that. Because when you check, you will see that this has no basis. The thought does not last long enough for you to be dragged anywhere. And what you really are, that which perceives thought, has no change, has no movement, there's no real dragging. For some of you, if you find these attention-oriented techniques natural and helpful, like to stay with the sense I am, is a very beautiful method. Or to chant the holy name of the Lord, like Ram, is a very beautiful method. If you find any of these more natural, this is very good as well. Here, in those times where I was looking for the truth, it did not seem that natural. I experimented, I tried various things, various sadhanas for even long periods of time. But something led me to this effortlessness. The simple openness, the simple allowing, which seemed to be without self-judgment, without too much trying to hold on to something. Like I say sometimes, to get to identity. Your identity is stored in a bank locker. Have you heard this example from me? Your identity is stored in a bank locker. Now, at least in India, how does the bank locker work? You have one key and the banker has another. And when you go to the bank, what you have to do is, you have to put both the keys, and only then does the locker work. One key is not enough. You see? So to get to your identity, you need both the keys of attention as well as belief. You need the key which is, you perceive this thought construct, which is attention. You see? Perception is just attention. But also you need to give your assent to this thought construct, that yes, this is true or it has meaning. You see? When both are there, then identity or separation seems real. Now, if for some of you it just feels natural, I don't have to put the first key at all, no attention, finished, you see. It can be anything. There are every single technique. Like some have this sense of imagining the face of your master. Anything, whatever keeps your attention naturally present, you see, is good enough. But identity is formed when attention and belief function. And I find that to let go of even attention for me seems like a very natural way, if you can call it a way. And the good thing is that we have everything in our toolkits. We'll say, some of you will say, but belief just goes automatically. You know, it just, when the thoughts come, I just end up believing them, you see. But you don't believe many of your thoughts. You see? So many of them just come and go, and you don't end up giving them belief. You see? So it is not inherent, belief is not inherent in the thought itself. Otherwise, we would not need the term belief at all. We would not talk about belief if the arising of thought itself inherently means that it is believed. Then what is the point of belief? There is no term like belief then. You see, then thought would encapsulate it. You see? So if the thought came that I am a green mosquito. You see, all nonsense thoughts come. You see? Then it's not so easily believed. You see? But it's only that which we have identified with. We can use the term interest there in a way, but thoughts that we have identified with or seem to hold some meaning for us. You see? That if I do this, then I will get freedom, for example, because I'm speaking to an audience of spiritual seekers in a way, then thoughts about freedom can get more belief. Somebody who's interested in ice skating only in their life, you see, or wrestling, will not be toward freedom. What you're talking about, you see, they will not get easily identified with those. So the belief is not inherent in the thought itself. You see? Imagine how that would be. Anything, then thought would come, and it's just, I'm a green mosquito flapping. You know, it could be anything. Who can say what their next thought is going to be? Nobody can guarantee to me that they know for certain. Their next thought is not going to be, I am a green mosquito. Nobody can guarantee. So, if it was just so inherent in the arising of the thought, then you just like, the thought comes and you're just caught. So it doesn't work like that. You see that these thoughts come, and there's a subtle power of giving it truth value, yes. Truth value, no. But to determine the truthiness of it, the meaning in it, you see, is a primal functioning of consciousness, as primal as attention is, you see. And this is called belief. So then, why does it seem like some of them just get me? Some of them, they come like that, why does it? Because we have identified or nurtured those with our belief in the past. Yeah. So what to do about those? That depends on your temperament. Those which just seem to get me, then what to do about those depends on your temperament. If your temperament is more inquiry type, like what is going on, if you very attracted to these, why is life like this and what is going on, yeah, these kind of questions, then you can then inquiry, you are very well suited to inquiry. So then you take on this thought and say, who does it belong to? If the oppressive thought is saying, for example, oh, you will never come to freedom, or you are so far from it, you see, then you pull that in and say, who is it about? Who is this really about? Who will not come to their freedom? And you don't leave this. You see, you keep, whenever you, life gives you some space for it, you pull this into your inquiry and don't leave it till the venom is pulled out of it. till it becomes defanged, till its ability to cause you this sense of suffering is not extracted out of it, then you keep asking and say, who is it about? For some of you, this seems like too much work, who wants to do this stuff, you know, this kind of thing, it just doesn't appeal to you, you see, and you are more in your heart in this way, just devotional, then you would say, whatever this problem is not mine. It is my master's or it is the Lord's. Guru Kripa Kevalam. And the beauty of this is the more you truly surrender in your heart, the more you see that it is just so apparent that everything is being taken care of by the Supreme Intelligence, whether you call it the Sadguru or whether you call it consciousness, that doesn't matter. And the more you see this, the easier it becomes to surrender. It's a very virtuous way, virtuous circle in a way. But you come to this point where most of these thoughts then will just, they come and go. And they'll not seem so big, so strong, so powerful. The gravity, the magnetism will not seem so strong. To experience your freedom, to experience your reality, to experience the self, to experience your sage-like nature, all you have to do is experience one moment of motionlessness. One moment where you just forget about it, whatever it might be. That's all that any master is actually asking. Now if you refer to them in your memory, then it is constantly asking for that one moment. Is it? But the truth is deeper than that, which your mind cannot fathom. It's actually just about this one moment. This one moment. That's all. Just this one moment. Don't have to worry about even the concept one moment. Just fully open. Everything can flow as it likes. Attention, perception, nothing matters. Everything is just fine. past, no future, just now. It's the simplest for you. Simplest for you means impossible for the mind, but simplest for you. So if you try to put it in your conceptual box, then it will become complex again. All I'm saying is give me one moment. Forget about everything. Don't judge yourself. Don't rush to meaning. It appears that it requires some practice withholding belief. It works very well sometimes. Bhagavan said two set of things. He said, don't believe your thoughts, and the body is a thought, and the mind is a thought, and in the world is a thought. All these are just thoughts. But he also said that if it feels like it takes some effort to withdraw belief, then make that seeming effort till you see that even that is grace. If you feel that to give yourself one moment when you are free from interpretations, judgments, seems like it takes an effort, then make it. Also Bhagavan had said something very beautiful along with this. He said, even I am God is a thought. That means is don't try to replace like I am the person idea with another better idea. Definitely don't be concerned about your progress. In the sense of many times we are trying to let go, but we are trying to let go with one eye open, like I said, surrender with one eye open. It's like, I'm going to be notionless, but what's happening to me then? Am I making progress? Am I becoming more free? This kind of thing. Why I say it like that? Surrender with one eye open means I'm surrendering everything to you, Father. Just please make sure it goes fine. You still have an eye on whether it is fine or not, or what fine actually means. Then it's not surrender actually, it's just deal making. So when you let go of your notions, don't keep yourself anchored to the notion of freedom or progress or getting it or not getting it. Then you really see that what Bhagavan said, I am the body is an idea, a thought, I am the mind is a thought, I am God is a thought, I am the world is a thought, I am in time is a thought, I am in space is a thought. All of these, there's thoughts. Welcome, my dear. Then I think Bhagavan said physical reality is an illusion. Physical reality is reality is an illusion. Though this could be seen as another idea, it helps eliminate a lot of fears. Maya means everything that can be measured. Everything that can be measured means everything that can be fathomed. Everything that has duration. Everything that changes, comes and goes. In India we call it Maya. And this Maya is roughly translated into illusion. But actually, if you look at what Shankara said about Maya, he said that it is indeterminable. Neither can we say that it exists, nor can we say that it doesn't exist. As opposed to, it's, yeah, see, unfathomable. As opposed to putting it in a straight box, which is illusion, therefore not real or something. It apparently exists as long as it is seen through, is what could be a tame definition of what was trying to be conveyed. If you look at these ideas some more, you'll see that to say that the physical appearance is an illusion is very helpful to, you said, to eliminate fears.
Yes.
But what is the layer in which this elimination of fears is happening? Also a physical appearance, still phenomenal. You see? So if it is an illusion, then how does it matter whether fears are being eliminated or not? So it's like saying, once I believe that the world is an illusion, my life in the world becomes better. So therefore our allegiance is still towards how to make my life better in the world. You see? And this dichotomy will also lead to suffering, as all dichotomies do, although they might seem to provide some initial relief. You see, if our heart is still on how to make my physical existence better, then although to repeat to ourselves this physical existence is just illusory might seem to provide some relief, but the point is that our attachment is still to how we are doing in this physical existence, you see. And this duality, any duality in the mind, leads to suffering. So that's why I say truth must be for truth's sake, not for any benefit of the truth. See? And I feel like all of you are very tough on yourselves. Because for me it does feel like you're in this for truth's sake, because why would you be here otherwise? At least in satsang like this, there is nothing else on offer actually. So, truth for truth's sake, independent of what then happens in your phenomenal existence, is very, very potent a statement. Is it? Because it includes surrender, it includes true knowingness, that which we call in truth. Therefore, good to see what is it that I really want. What do I really want? And not with the perspective of beating yourself up or getting attached to these answers, but just to see that it is not true. It is just some byproducts that we heard about in some books. But I feel that all of you really in this, because you don't want to give a cent to lies anymore. You're tired of lying to yourself, you're tired of all of this fake stuff. And that is why you allow yourself to let go of these deeply held belief systems, even though the letting go of them may involve many times some painful seeming releasing happening. Okay, let me say it simply. Our beliefs are what we hold on to as if they are true. Isn't it? That's what a belief is. Concepts we hold on to as if they are true. See? Now, we hold on to them because we feel like they are of some value. See? Like, suppose holding on to this hand, you feel like it is of some value. See? But if it was to be snatched away, then you feel like, no, I don't want to give that up. See? So, when you come to satsang and your beliefs are questioned, see, it is not always going to be a fun process, because you're holding on to them because you feel like it is of some values. So when it is said, to know even one thing is to know too much, or some statement like that, I feel like, no, I feel like I need to know this stuff, you see. These things, I've given up all the nonsense, and now what I have left is very pristine, you see. And then it is looked into together and you're like, no, it's not, you see. And you don't necessarily like that. Because in the world, we have been told that if you know nothing, you are dumb. You're like, you don't want to, nobody wants to be dumb. And yet, what do they say? Who was the wisest man? They say, no? In at least Western philosophy, they say, the wisest man who ever lived was Socrates. Why was he the wisest man who ever lived? The wisest human who ever lived, because he said that I know only one thing, which is that I know nothing. All these things that we think are so meaningful, relevant, important to our life, all the concepts that we have of reality, don't come close to reality. All the firecrackers are going off now, and Diwali in India is celebrated this way. All this beautiful light and sound, and also not so beautiful smoke. And you picked the perfect time to get back. Thank you. So one trap that all of us can also avoid is that rather than thinking a lot about notionlessness and then feeling happy about the virtues of notionlessness, you see, and the benefits of notionlessness, allow yourself to taste this motionlessness. Allow yourself to let go of trying to conceptualize even this. All that needs to be said about it for the moment is being said using this mouth anyway, so you don't have to trouble yourself with any of that. Enjoy your notionless existence. A little bit of trust is good, because the serpent mind will come and tell you, look, if you just remain motionless, you will end up badly, or like, this is not going to end well. You will end up, like Guruji says, like a beggar on the street. Some worst case scenario it will play out for you. This is just fear mongering, fear tactics of the mind. That's why Guruji has given us all this reassurance that anyone who has come to this reality has never regretted it. In India, we have so many examples of the entire spectrum of life, of sages living those lives of great luxury and of just nothing in their name. Not even where the next meal is coming from. But King Janaka was as happy as Baba Jan sitting on the roadside in Pune. Says this will not end well for you, I want to tell you that there is no way for it but to end well. It can only end well. All my love, all my best wishes. Many in India celebrate Diwali as the new year. So may this year bring all what your heart truly desires. you all so much for being in satsang today. Sadguru Shri Muji Baba ki jai.
Sadguru Shri Ananta ji ki jai.
Guru Kripa Kevalam. Okay, let's end with this. This is good. Bhagwan had written two verses on the day of Diwali on the request of a devotee. The demon Naraka, which is ego, who rules hell, the notion that I am this body, where is this demon inquiring thus with the discus of jnana? And discus is that weapon, you know, that weapon with that Krishna has sometimes when he's angry. The discus of jnana, Narayana, destroys the demon. And this day is Naraka Chaturdashi, shining as the self in glory. After slaying Naraka, the sinner vile who suffered much, the sinner vile, V-I-L-E, who suffered much, who suffered much because he deemed as I, the wretched, home of pains, the body of flesh. This is the festival of light, Deepavali. So may this egotism be slain by the discus of the Sadguru's light, and this may this light forever shine through your presence in this world. Guru Kripa Kevalam. Love you, love you, love you.